Blackstone presents Paper Belt on Fire: How Renegade Investors Sparked a Revolt Against the University by Michael Gibson. This book is read by Alex Boyles. For my Serapian brothers, Satoshi, Copperthwaite, Wolf, Nozick, Zamyatin, and Mom. At first sight, it would seem that the deep interior of the sun and stars is less accessible to scientific investigation than any other region of the universe. Our telescopes may probe farther and farther into the depths of space, but how can we ever obtain certain knowledge of that which is hidden behind substantial barriers? What appliance can pierce through the outer layers of a star and test the conditions within? The Internal Constitution of the Stars, Arthur S. Eddington, 1926. But I reckon I got to light out for the territory ahead of the rest, because Aunt Sally, she's going to adopt me and civilize me, and I can't stand it. I've been there before. The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn, Mark Twain, 1884. Prologue. Oh, you guys are full of shit, Bill Gates exploded at me. Total shit. Gates was pissed. His brow had furrowed above his trademark glasses. We were arguing, and every time he scored a point, he did this little hip sway hop as though he were raining fact and reason down upon me in a series of overhead tennis smashes. This was not the genial billionaire scholar that I'd seen on TV carrying a canvas bag full of books. Nor was he the gentleman philanthropist patiently explaining his efforts to improve the lives of the world's poor. Gates kept that man in reserve for the magazines and Sunday newspapers. Here was the fire, the indignation I had only read about in memoirs and business histories. This was the CEO who had ruthlessly crushed Apple and IBM over and over for decades, and who, during Microsoft's epic antitrust showdown with the Justice Department, had offered the prosecution nothing but contempt, evasion, and ridicule during 3 days of direct examination. All it had taken was a single question from me to bring the ferocious entrepreneur in him back to life, and it was abundantly clear that the then richest man on earth thought I was an idiot for even asking it. My heart leapt. A ripple of exhilarating mischief shot through me. The game was on. It was June 2014, and we were standing in the perfectly white art gallery of the Villa Simone, Charles Simone's oddly jointed mansion on the shores of Lake Washington, just outside Seattle. Simone, the chief architect of Microsoft Office and inventor of Word and Excel, had come a long way since he'd fled Soviet-dominated Hungary in 1966 and arrived in America, aged 16, with nothing. In 2007, he'd paid $25 million to enjoy 10 days orbiting the Earth. He'd arrived in a Soyuz spacecraft at the International Space Station bearing gifts. Martha Stewart, his then-girlfriend, had packed him a gourmet picnic of roasted quail and duck breast to share with the cosmonauts on board. On this terrestrial night, however, Simone was hosting a fundraising dinner for the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton, the highest temple of theoretical physics. The Institute's first academic hire when it opened in 1933 was Albert Einstein. Its second, the polymath John von Neumann. Its scholars have since invented the modern computer, won 33 Nobel Prizes, and earned 42 Fields Medals. Tremendous brains, all of them. But like any other nonprofit organization, they had to raise money from donors, which was why Simone had gathered 30 of Seattle's brainiest well-to-do, including his old friend Bill Gates, to eat and chat about physics below his collection of Roy Lichtenstein's comic strip paintings. The historian of technology George Dyson had invited me with the hope that I might spark a conversation on the future of education with some of the attendees. I suspect I did not disappoint him. I'd been seated at dinner next to Simone at the head table, 3 people away from Gates, so I didn't get to talk to him directly as we ate. But once the tables had been cleared and coffee was served, people were milling about. I decided I had to approach Microsoft's founder. "Hi, Mr. Gates. I'm Michael Gibson. I work for Peter Thiel." "Yes, I know, Peter," he said, sounding like your kindest uncle. Then I asked the question. It was something Thiel had talked about in public since around 2006. Now, more than 15 years later, many tenured academics have written treatises on the topic, and a respectable body of scholarship has formed debating the issue. But for most of the world in 2014, hypnotized by smartphones and tangled up in the web, it was no more than an eccentric grumble. Very few in the mainstream took the question seriously, though the early murmurs had been amplified by the economist Tyler Cowen in The Great Stagnation and later by Robert Gordon in The Rise and Fall of American Growth. So, I asked Gates, "What do you think of the idea that we're not seeing as much innovation and scientific progress as we should, that the rate of progress has stalled?" The change in his demeanor was instantaneous. A fast-moving wave of irritation swept across his face. It was the most alive Gates had looked all night. His sudden intensity caught me by surprise. "Oh, you guys are full of shit. Total shit." "You guys." It lit me up how animated he'd become. All at once, he became a statistical geyser, spouting positive facts about the improved well-being of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.